This is the final part on our design of the parallel couple comb line filter. This part we're going to do an EM simulation and compare that to the other simulations that we have done. This is our circuit. We've done the physical design of the three coupled microstrip resonators here, and we have capacitors which will be implemented as surface mount capacitors. We're going to use the optimized MC-Lin based BPF values, so these are our capacitor values. And in the EM simulation, we're going to build a microwave circuit up using capacitors, lumped capacitors in this case, and we're going to have a three-port network which implements our EM subcircuit. That three-port EM network is going to be simulated using an electromagnetic simulator. So at the top level, when we're in the microwave circuit simulator, we're going to set this up. So this EM circuit looks like a subcircuit. As far as our simulator is concerned, it just happens to get values by calling a computer program to do the simulation. So when that EM simulator is running, it is going to produce a table of S parameters, and of course at each frequency there is going to be a 3x3 matrix of complex S parameters, and those S parameters are going to be read into the microwave circuit simulator itself and used as part of the analysis. For the EM subcircuit, we need to lay out our microstrip lines in an enclosure, and that whole enclosure, which is a box, a three-dimensional box, becomes our electromagnetic environment. And so here is the layout of our circuit with the correct width, spacing, and length of our lines. We have to define a number of things now that we didn't have to define before. For example, right here, we have a VIO. We have to specify the nature of that VIA and we've had to draw it. Well, there are a number of standard ways of drawing these structures, and these EM simulators, called 2.5D simulators, are designed just for microstrip circuits. So everything is set up knowing that we have microstrip circuits that are going to be on substrates and that we're going to have VIAs. For the EM simulation, we need to define our VIAs. We're going to choose tantalum VIAs. That's the metal, is tantalum. And the VIAs are going to be 400 micron by 400 micron. And in the simulator, they need to be square. In reality, they'll end up being cylinders. Even if we use a mask which is square, they'll pretty much come out as being round. We need to choose the metallization. We're going to choose 6 micron gold metallization. This will be both the ground plane and for the microstrip themselves. And then we need to choose our EM enclosure. We must put our microstrip inside a box. In fact, when we build this circuit, we're going to put it inside a box as well because we don't want our stray fields. But our simulation requires an EM enclosure. And we have a choice as to the conducting walls. We're going to choose an EM enclosure that has perfect conducting walls. There will be a ground plane, which will be our real 6 micron thick gold metallization. And the top of the box is going to have perfect conducting walls as well as the four walls. We need to choose dimensions of our box. We're going to choose a box which is 22 millimeters by 20 millimeters by 5.635 millimeters. That's just 5 millimeters plus the thickness of the substrate. The way we would choose this, well, we'd choose it to be the actual dimensions of the box we want to use. If we don't know what that box size is going to be, well, we want the separation from the microstrip line to the sidewall to be quite a bit more than the separation of two microstrip lines. And we usually want that to be about 2 or 3 times as much. And this separation is chosen the same way. After setting everything up and running a simulation, these are the results that we get. Now, the EM simulation probably takes about 1,000 times longer than the MC-Lin based simulation. And here I've plotted the S21 responses for the MC-Lin based analysis and the S21 response for the EM, but I've only plotted the S11 response for the EM. Looking at the S21 responses for the moment, we see that they are essentially the same. We certainly see below the center of the passband that they match very closely. The passband is just about the same, but we do notice that the bandwidth is a little bit less. That is, with the EM analysis, the bandwidth is a little bit less. And that is an indication that the coupling is a little bit less. We also notice that this notch has moved. But we're going to talk about that a little bit more later on. Let's look at S11 in the EM analysis. we see that it is no longer symmetrical. It has shifted just a little bit. Now, we could optimize this a little bit further, but we're not going to do that. We're going to take these results and compare them to the MC Lin-based analysis and try and describe why we see these very slight differences. But essentially, the EM analysis and the MC Lin analysis are reasonably close, and certainly the MC Lin analysis is much closer to the ideal after optimization than it was before, and the EM analysis is just a little bit further away from the MC Lin analysis. So the right strategy to use here is to do exactly what we have done. We've done a synthesis, we then went on to use the MC Lin analysis, and so let's compare the responses. With the EM analysis, there are some subtle differences with the MC Lin-based analysis. With the MC Lin-based analysis, we could specify the dimensions we had for our lines exactly. Of course, we're not going to be able to take into account variations due to kind of etching errors, though probably of the order of the thickness of the metal. Our metal is 6 microns thick, so we're probably going to have a little bit of a rough edge on our microstrip line, which is 6 microns or so up and down. So that seems very small, of course, but it is enough to affect things very slightly, especially the loss. But in the EM analysis, we had to define a grid that we were using, and we need a very regular grid. And that is because these 2.5D analyses use a special trick which enables a fast Fourier transform to be used, and that's one of the reasons why it's so fast. We don't need to go into the details of the EM analysis. It means that we essentially need a regular grid in the x and the y direction. So delta x is going to be the same and delta y is going to be the same. There are various tools that enable some variation, but our main problem is that we have a line which has a finite width and there's a finite separation. And the separation was 1150 microns and the width was 5 microns. So it seems as though if we had a delta y of about 50 microns, we would be able to accommodate both. So we've done as good a job as we can in trying to make sure that the gridding matches the physical geometry. So the grid is 50 microns wide, but still the gridding is finite, and if we wanted better EM analysis, we would have to use a smaller grid, but it will take much longer to run. I'm pretty happy with where we are at the moment, because I believe in manufacturing, we're going to have variations which are greater than the variations that the EM restrictions have imposed. There are some subtle effects that are captured in the EM simulation that were not captured in the MC Lin analysis. And one of those is the coupling of the vias. So we have these vertical posts that are all next to each other, and there's going to be some coupling between those. Those vias will have fairly high current flows through them, so there'll be magnetic fields around them and there will be some coupling. And perhaps that coupling is resulting in this variation that we're seeing here. We know that this notch here is due to a cancellation effect. We've talked about that. We assume that there's a cancellation effect here because there is one path, and this is the path that we included in our synthesis process, which takes us from one microstrip line to a second microstrip line to a third, and then we have a direct coupling path from line 1 to line 3. Our vias do the same thing. They provide an extra level of coupling, and it could be that that coupling has cancelled out the coupling that's come from the microstrip line itself. So let's talk about some of the differences. The EM-based filter simulation shows a smaller bandwidth, and this is indicative of lower overall coupling. The stronger the coupling, the broader the bandwidth. The lower the coupling, the narrower the bandwidth. If we were doing an EM optimization here, perhaps the lines need to be a little bit further apart to reduce the coupling. The notch above the passband has shifted lower. Well, we have some subtle cancellation effects going on here, and maybe we've shifted the levels of one of those extra coupling paths. The overall response, though, is basically the same as the MC Lin-based analysis. Only a very small difference has occurred. We could interpret what is happening with this S11, that there's a little bit of mismatch at the center of the passband, and that may be all that is causing this change. So it may not be so much a coupling effect that we're seeing, but perhaps it is just a little bit of extra mismatch. So coupling may not be to blame at all. So the right strategy to follow is to use the MC-LIN-based analysis to optimize the design. Once we've got this design, go and do an EM simulation, and then you could optimize that EM simulation just a little bit. Here's the response on the Smith chart. We see in this central region here that the response is not symmetrical, and we really like the response. So our origin is right in this middle point here. Well, let's quickly compare this to the results of the MC-LIN analysis. So there's the MC-LIN result, and back here is the EM analysis. Here's the MC-LIN analysis again. Here's the MC-LIN analysis again, and those responses look almost identical, except for the difference that's occurring around the origin. So let's zoom in on the origin. That's exactly what I've done here. So we have the two results superimposed. The purple line here is the result of the MC-LIN analysis. The red line here is the result of the EM analysis. And we see they follow very similar curves. This is the plot of the S11 response. And what happens in the center of the passband is all relative to this origin, right at those crosshairs there. So let's interpret what is going on here. We see our purple line, this is the MC-LIN based analysis, is pretty symmetrical around this origin. We have this classic looping that we see in the Chebyshev response, and it is completely symmetrical. We see that we get close to the origin, and then we loop out. So when we're close to the origin, S11 is becoming low, so we have a zero of the S11 response. Then it loops out. Then we have another zero of the S11 response. Then it loops out. We come back, and we have another zero of the S11 response. And of course, the zeros of the S11 response are the poles of the S21 response. Let's look at the EM analysis now. We're coming along here. We see we don't get as close to the origin. Then we have a loop. It's still a loop, but it's a very tight loop at this stage. We come back in again. We see we have another zero of the S11 response. Then we loop out and we see, well, we're actually quite a distance away from the origin here. And so maybe we won't see that zero. This distance all along here looks very similar. Let's pull up out a little bit so we can still see the details around the origin. We're looking at the rectangular plot of the responses now. And here's our S11. Yes, we see the zero. That's this zero here corresponds to the zero that we're seeing here. There's another zero showing up, which would be this zero, and that's corresponding to that. And we never really see this other zero. But you can see that these two responses are very close to each other. It would take very small change in our capacitor values to make the EM-based response, the one in red, to look perfectly symmetrical. Here is the wideband response. This is the wideband response after an EM analysis. And this is basically the same as the MC-LIN-based analysis. If we overlaid the two results, we wouldn't be able to tell the difference. So let's talk a little bit about the manufacturing concerns that we would have when we build this filter. Because in manufacturing, of course, we're going to have a lot of tolerancing issues. We are not going to faithfully reproduce our filter to the level of accuracy that we want. And the level of accuracy that we would have to achieve in manufacturing to get identical results or near identical results to our EM-based analysis would be around about 0.1%, or maybe even less. Our EM analysis has errors in it, as does our MC-LIN analysis. For one, we do not know the permittivity of our substrate as accurate as 0.1%. In fact, the permittivity is going to vary a little bit during the manufacturing process. When we compress the substrate, we have a little bit higher density around the metal. we're going to have a little bit higher permittivity. So we cannot control our material properties to 0.1%. We cannot control the conductivity of our metallization to 0.1%. So there will be some variation. For example, our lines are 500 microns wide. We are going to have a variation in the width due to etching, which is going to be comparable to the thickness of the metal. So what all of that means is that every manufactured filter is going to need to be tuned. It's either going to be tuned robotically or else a human is going to have to tune it. Mostly what they're going to do is change the capacitance of our lumped element capacitors, and they're usually going to do that by drilling away a little bit of the ceramic. So we cannot expect our manufacturing tolerances to be better than about 1%. So greater accuracy than that is required with most of our microwave filters. For example, in a cell phone, we want an accuracy of about 1 part in 1,000 at least in order to meet the filtering specs. Again, tuning is done by adjusting the capacitor values. We really do not want to change our lines at all. We just want to fabricate the lines. And when we do the design, we want to make sure that there are enough things that we can adjust easily that we can get our design to work. In summary, we have designed a filter and we have synthesized it using a methodical process. We then used microwave simulation to optimize the design, but it was also a sanity check to make sure that our process of design was correct. We used EM simulation as a check because there are other coupling mechanisms that cannot be captured otherwise, and every filter that we manufacture will require tuning. So we've spent quite a lot of time talking about the design of a PCL filter, but there is a bigger picture. What we covered here are all the key ideas in linear microwave design. So all of the techniques that we've used, the way we got out of difficulties, are things that we can use whenever we're designing linear microwave circuits. Filter design is about the most extreme case where you run into problems all the time and you have to work a way out of it. It's one of the reasons why seasoned microwave filter designers say that all microwave design comes down to filter design.